I think he's here, and Inan Şahin from Ankara University. The title of the talk is Parallel Lives Model and Its Implications on Special Theory of Relativity. Inan Hocam, are you here?
Can you hear my voice?
Yes, yes, I can hear. Now we can see you as well.
Thank you, thank you. And share.
We can share. Yep, we can see.
I'm sorry. Okay, I can start.
Hocam, 25 minutes for the talk and 5 minutes question answer usually, as usual. So I will remind you in the last 2 minutes.
Okay, thank you.
About it. Thank you very much. We are listening to you, Hocam.
Today I want to talk about a recently proposed model of quantum theory known as parallel lives. And we also discuss its implications on theory of relativity. The parallel lives is a model which provides an interpretation of quantum theory that's both local and realistic. According to parallel lives, all quantum fields are composed of point being called lives. They are moving on continuous warp lines with a speed bounded by the speed of light. Here, these lives are represented by black dots moving on the light cone. The lives can only interact locally and split into copies when their warp lines coincide. However, not all lives whose warp lines coincide interact with another. Lives have a memory of their previous interactions, and this memory determines which liv they will interact with. Lives that do not interact are invisible to each other, and we say that these invisible lives are living in different worlds. The network of internal interactions of a very large collection of lives forms a macroscopic system. And if a liv is hidden relative to one of the lives that make up the macroscopic system, it should also be hidden relative to other lives in that macroscopic system.
Sorry to interrupt. Is it possible to make it full screen, the PDF?
Okay, I will try.
I think if you go to Görünüm, there should be, yeah. Thank you, and sorry for the interruption.
Okay. Sorry. Okay, thus it's possible to have a macroscopic, I'm sorry, I have a problem. Okay. It's sometimes said that the collection of lives that make up the macroscopic system forms a bubble. For example, here we see two interacting lives represented by black dots here. They split into copies when they interact, and two blue and two black lives are formed. And they are hidden with respect to each other. And after many interaction steps, we have then two bubbles, two macroscopic systems living in parallel. This property actually recalls the many-worlds interpretation. However, in many-worlds interpretation, the entire universe split into copies, while in parallel lives, lives locally split into relative worlds. There is no reduction of the state vector in the parallel lives model. Each orthogonal term in the superposition lives parallel in spacetime. For example, consider Einstein-Podolsky-Rosen type experiment with two spin-off particles in the single state. And let A and B be space-like separated microscopic observer systems. They are carrying Stengerla apparatuses. And after spins become entangled in the single state at the midpoint, then one moves to A and the other to B. Then the leaves of the spins and observers, A and B, split into two copies. These copies here are represented by blue and green bubbles. In one bubble, spin is up and the observer measures spin up. And in the other bubble, spin is down and the observer measures spin down. These blue and green bubbles are hidden here with respect to each other. These bubbles then propagate in space, when they meet, the blue one merges with blue and the green one merges with green to form bigger bubbles. And as you see, the correlation between spins at A and B is preserved in each bubble. What we have seen so far was a realization of the parallel lifts model. However, the model can also be studied without referring to lifts as fundamental constituents of quantum fields. We know that a system's density operator actually determines to everything that is locally observable on it. However, the density operator of a system A and B, system A and system B, do not determine the density operator of the composite system AB. Yet, in a local realistic theory, the state of composite system is determined by the state of its subsystems. We can then draw the conclusion that quantum theory is not local realistic. However, this conclusion is wrong, as Deutsch and Heidenwald shown in their 1999 paper. As they said in their own words, all information in quantum systems is, notwithstanding Bell's theorem, localized. Measuring or otherwise interacting with a quantum system S has no effect on distant systems from which S is dynamically isolated, even if they are entangled with S. This result is indeed surprising, but the crucial point here is that the density operators do not contain all the information about the system. There should be two different types of states, the nominal states and phenomenal states. Here we borrow the terminology from Kant's philosophy. In Kant's philosophy, a noumenon is an object that exists independently of human sense, in contrast with the term phenomenon, which refers to any object of the senses. Therefore, the nominal state of a system is its complete local description. On the other hand, the phenomenal state of a system is a complete description of what is locally observable in that system. Here, actually, we employ the formalism of Raymond Robicou, but it was shown that it is isomorphic to the formalism of Deutsch and Haydn. Now, let's see some notation. The systems are represented by capital Latin letters, A, B, C. The nominal states are represented by capital N, with a superscript indicating which system they belong to. And phenomenal states are represented by Greek rho. They actually correspond to usual density operators. We have operations U, V, W on systems. Operations can act on both nominal and phenomenal states, but for each phenomenal action, there exists an operator in the Hilbert space, and it acts on the corresponding density operator in a usual way. The leaves we have seen before correspond to nominal states. Hence, the amount of information they carry in their memory exceeds the information provided by the density operators. Now, after a brief summary of the parallel lifts model, we will now revisit the Hardy's paradox. In 1992, Hardy proposed the Gedanken experiment, consists of two Mach-Zehnder interferometers, one for positrons and one for electrons. And the experiment here is designed so that the U plus and U minus paths of these two interferometers overlap. And if the positron takes U plus paths and the electron takes U minus paths, they will meet at P and annihilate one another. So at point P, a pair annihilation occurs. We actually know from Mach-Zehnder interferometers that D detectors cannot detect signal due to destructive interference. However, the presence of the pair annihilation process at P makes D detections possible. And it can be shown that after the particles pass point P, but before they reach, these BS2 minus and BS2 plus are second beam splitters. And before they reach the second beam splitters, the initial state evolves to the following state. And the beam splitters, second beam splitters, perform the following transformations. So it can be shown that in 1/16 of the experiments, both of the DE detectors, D plus and D minus, receive signals. And we will concentrate this case where both of the D detectors detect signal. Hardy then considered two frame of references we call S plus and S minus frames. The relative velocities of these frames to laboratory frame are so arranged that these measurements are not simultaneous with respect to S plus and S minus. In S plus frame, the measurement on the positron occurs before the electron arrives at second beam splitter. Then according to an observer in the S plus frame, the state vector is reduced to the following state. Consequently, the observer in the S plus frame concludes that the electron takes U minus and positron takes V plus steps. On the other hand, according to an observer in the S minus frame, the state vector is reduced to the following. Hence, the observer in S minus concludes that the positron takes U plus and electron takes V minus paths. So we see from this analysis that different frame of references infer different results for particle trajectories. Therefore, the prediction of quantum mechanics about particle trajectories is not Lorentz invariant. But can we conclude from these results that quantum mechanics and the relativity are inconsistent? Actually, no, we cannot say that exactly, because the observer's statements about particle trajectories here are counterfactual, which means we reason about what the measurement results will be without actually performing a measurement. However, if we adopt an interpretation in which the counterfactual statements are valid statements, they are legitimate, then we will indeed encounter an inconsistency. So the inconsistency depends on the interpretation here. Now, let us describe the Hardy's paradox in the parallelism model. Assume that we are in the S minus frame of reference, and at the instant when the positron has not yet reached the second beam splitter, but the electron reached the C minus or D minus detectors, then the following entangled state is obtained. There is a superposition here, and the leaves of the observer and the experimental apparatus then split into four different verbs, four different bubbles, say, corresponding to these orthogonal terms. But since we restrict ourselves to the case where both of the D detectors detect signal, we will concentrate on the third term here. This third term is represented by the following diagram. Here the dotted lines represent the hidden leaves. Then we see from this diagram that the leaves moving on U minus and V plus paths are hidden. On the other hand, according to an observer in the S plus frame of reference, at the instant when the electron has not yet reached the second beam splitter, but the positron reached the detectors C plus or D plus, then the following entangled state is obtained. Again, when we look at the third term, we see that it's described by the leaves of this diagram. We see that the leaves moving on U plus and V minus paths are hidden. Therefore, we see that observers in different reference frames observe different system of leaves. Since S minus and S plus observers observe different system of leaves, they must live in parallel in different worlds. The fact that different reference frames live parallel to each other in different worlds seems to fit the logic of parallel leaves at first sight. Hence, the parallel leaf model seems to overcome the dilemma in Hardy's paradox. However, as we will see, it cannot, actually. Because the observer in each reference frame observes not only the experimental apparatus, but also the observer in the other reference frame. We know from classical relativity that, I say classical because we ignore the quantum mechanics here. So we know from relativity that one observer's reasoning about the observations or records of another observer must coincide with second observer's first person observations. So third person and first person observations should be equivalent. What this means, for example, assume that S minus frame is moving with a relative velocity v with respect to S plus. And according to an observer at S plus, an event happens at time t plus and position x plus. By using a Lorentz transformation, then we can deduce the time of this event according to an observer at S minus. But this Lorentz transform time must coincide with first observer's S plus reasoning about the observations of observer at S minus. The observer in S plus frame observes the contracted ruler and dilated clock of the observer in S minus frame. And then she can state that the observer in the S minus frame using her contracted length and dilated time should observe that the event happens at time t minus. It's a third person perspective. This reflects the third person perspective. And this time is equal to the first person observation of S minus obtained from a Lorentz transformation. So in relativity, third person and first person perspectives are equal. But we will show that when quantum mechanics comes into play, this is not true anymore. Now let's describe the motion and the behavior of the leaves according to an observer in S minus. And denote the leaves of the observer in the S minus frame of reference, observing the measurement results C minus zero and D minus one by the following sign, by OS minus. Here zero means null detection. When the detector doesn't receive any signal, we write zero. When it detects, we write one. And let's denote the leaves of the experimental apparatus C minus zero and D minus one by the following symbol, and the leaves of the observer in S plus frame observed by S minus by OS plus third. Here the subscript third indicates that this describes a third person perspective. Observer in S minus frame observes, in her word, another observer in the S plus frame of reference, which she denotes observer S plus third. So we have three bubbles, three collection of leaves here. And when these three collection of leaves meet, they combine to form the following larger collection of leaves. This collection describes the joint system of the observers and the apparatus before the electron is detected at the detector. And after the electron arrives to the detector, the leaves evolves to the following system of leaves, the collection of leaves. On the other hand, the story is different according to an observer at S plus. It can be shown that the following collection of leaves is obtained for the joint system of the observers and apparatus. But these two collection of leaves are not equivalent. So from the analysis we performed, we get the following odd looking result. First person and third person perspectives of the same observer belong to different worlds. But if quantum laws apply equally to all observers, then OS plus third, observer plus S plus third, should not observe that the positron is detected before the electron. However, this result is incompatible with the relativity of the simultaneity, because observer S plus third is moving relative to observer S plus first, and the time order of the detection event should be reversed. Consequently, we encounter a discrepancy between special relativity and the parallel leaves model. Okay. Now, last part of my talk. First of all, I must say that what I will tell in this section is a speculation. I'm sorry. It's a speculation. I have no evidence, but I think it provides a solution to the contradiction we discussed in the previous section. If we persist in the realistic interpretations of the quantum mechanics, then this discrepancy with the theory of relativity needs to be resolved. One solution to discrepancy is to modify the theory of relativity by proposing a preferred frame of reference. However, there are obscurities in this approach, such as which criteria should be used to determine the preferred frame of reference. We will make the following speculation, which we believe offers a solution to the discrepancy and also fits the spirit of the parallelism model. There is no particular preferred frame of reference, but for each frame, there is always a word in which that frame is preferred. The word observed from an observer's first-person perspective is the word where the observer's stationary frame is preferred. Then the conventional Lorentz transformations are defined between first-person perspectives of the observers on different inertial frames of reference. For example, here, the blue box represents first-person word of the observer SK. And the green box represents the first-person word of SM. And then Lorentz transformations are defined between these words. So it's a transformation between different words, not a transformation the same word. The third-person observer, SM third, is there, and SK third, third-person perspective of observer of SK is there. And the transformations between observers in the first-person and third-person perspectives are non-standard transformations, these yellow ones. Obviously, these new transformations violate the Lorentz symmetry. However, the Lorentz symmetry is violated only for events associated with quantum entanglement between the observer and some quantum system. Therefore, we can say that Lorentz symmetry is almost valid. Indeed, if we average over a large sequence of quantum events or say an identically prepared ensemble of quantum systems, the Lorentz symmetry is restored. Okay. But then how we should interpret the difference between these third-person and first-person observers? What exactly does this mean? Does this mean that the observer OSM third in observer SK first words is a zombie, an unconscious being? Of course, here we don't use the word zombie as it is used in popular culture. Here, David Chalmers, philosopher David Chalmers, zombies, a creature that looks, talks and acts just like a human, but that has no inner awareness, no consciousness. Maybe we can interpret it that way, but I do not advocate this view. For example, if we want to explain with the example of Hardy's Gedanken experiment, we can say that the measurement performed by observer SK first and her conscious perception causes the state vector to collapse. But this does not mean that observer SM third is an unconscious being. It simply means that in observer SK first's world, observer SM third's perception of the measurement result has no effect on the state vector's collapse. All observers in different reference frames respect the order of events and recorded history that the observer SK first sees on Hardy's experimental setup. Okay, thank you for your patience and the references.
Thank you very much, Inan Çocan, for the nice talk. We have a question before I ask my question from Dr. Onur Kusuluk. Fermionic quantum systems cannot exist in superpositions of even an odd fermion number states according to parity superselection rule. It is possible to derive this superselection rule from Lorentz invariance via the spin statistics connection. Could the parallelized model tell something new about this?
All the details of the model have not been completed yet. People are working on the parallel leaves. The exact dynamics of the leaves is unknown. It's an active research area, so I don't know actually the answer.
I see. Thank you, John. And I have a very naive question because I just got introduced to the field, this problem. Well, the this Hardy paradox kind of just confirms that the quantum theory must be non-local and contextual. And like the KCBS inequality is an example of disproving non-contextual hidden variable models. Have you considered like in that perspective, in this
yes.
context?
Thank you. Actually, in his 1992 paper, Hardy proposed two different Gedanken experiments. In his first Gedanken experiment, he demonstrated an inequality-free version of the Bess theorem, similar to Greenberger, Horn, Zeringer paper. However, in his second Gedanken experiment, he demonstrated that if the elements of the reality corresponding to Lorentz invariant observables are themselves Lorentz invariants, then realistic interpretations of quantum mechanics are incompatible with special theory of relativity. We deal with his second Gedanken experiments. The non-locality is investigated in his first Gedanken experiment. They are different Gedanken experiments.
Thank you, Hocam. There's one more question from Zafer Gedik Hocam. Does the parallel lives model, beyond being an alternative interpretation, have experimentally accessible consequences similar to the weak measurements of two-state vector formalism?
Yes. I think it's he mentioned about the Aharonov's state interpretation.
Yes, yes, sir.
This model is not retrocausal model. Maybe you can interpret in that way, but it's not a retrocausality. There isn't any retrocausality in this model.
I see. One more question from Sadi Turgut Hocam. If each life is material, isn't there a problem with the conservation of energy when new ones are produced?
Yes. The number of lives is believed to be infinite. There are difficulties to also calculating the probabilities because we have infinite number of lives. Some people propose to use non-standard arithmetic to calculate these probabilities. So there isn't any unconservation.
Sure, go ahead, Hocam, please.
There is a question, are the leaves countably infinite or uncountable? Uncountable, I think.
Okay. Is there any more question? I think we can continue a couple of more minutes if there are questions. If not, thank you very much, Inan Şahin Hocam, for the nice talk.
Thank you.
And